Boy, brother, I'm telling you, it has been a week.
Oh, it's always been a week.
Yep. You would think being on vacation would be a good week. Ooh, wrong side. Let's put the aliens on.
Oh, there you go.
But it has been a hell of a week.
Always.
And it's been a decent week, though, I guess. I mean, for the most part. Yesterday was the anniversary. Went to a movie.
Nice.
It was cool. My wife gave me a really awesome couple of glasses.
Nice.
One Jason and one Chucky.
Awesome.
So, I watched part three again this morning, and as you said, 100% completely different.
Yes.
Totally, total different movie. I mean, it's amazing how different they can be. It's very much like Halloween 6 and the Halloween 6 producer's cut. Totally different.
Yeah.
What we're talking about is the Alien 3 director's cut.
From 2003.
It is extremely different than the original cut.
Yes. The very beginning of this movie is quite different.
Mm-hmm.
Quite different. And then there's some added footage in the middle, and honestly, I think
they changed a lot. It's a completely different story, even. They totally changed things. He bought the alien, what is it, quadrology?
Whatever they called it.
And neither of us have ever seen the director's cut.
So we decided to watch it.
We decided to watch it and do our review on it. It is such a different film than the original Alien 3 theatrical cut that we both had to go back individually and watch the theatrical cuts again just so we can make sure we got everything right and compare the two. As we said, very, very different. Lots of changes.
Some changes were definitely for the best in this film, because it... And I'll get to that in the con section. Yeah, but there were some okay things that they took out that could have been kept in. But for the most part, I think the theatrical version was the better version.
That's what I was going to ask you. Which is your better version?
The theatrical.
I also prefer the theatrical version.
Yes.
They did some things in the director's version, which just wasn't... It didn't seem as
didn't
good.
Flow.
Didn't make sense. And a lot of the added scenes they put in just kind of added length without substance.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
This movie was directed by David Fincher, and it stars again... I don't say that again as in bad, but Sigourney Weaver as Ellen Ripley and Charles Dutton as Dylan. And the reason I'm only just mentioning those two is those are basically the two biggest characters in this film.
Yes, yes. You do have Frank Black, but he doesn't have a very big role in this film. But he does come back as Bishop the Droid for a short part. And then as the creator and designer of the Bishop Android at the end.
Yeah, I'm not sure if they gave him a name. I really didn't check the credits much to look. So.
No, they never really named him.
So this movie came out in 1992. And for your viewing enjoyment, we have the theatrical version sitting over here.
VHS.
And then we have I just brought this from home because I wanted to bring it and show it. It is the Alien and Predator Total Destruction Collection, which I've had. It doesn't have the special editions on it. I wish it did.
No.
But it's still a really cool set, and I really enjoy it.
Yeah.
But, so the basic storyline is this movie takes up pretty much right after Aliens. And Ripley's spaceship crashes.
Well, I don't know if it really crashes.
Well... They have to get into an escape pod, and the escape pod crashes.
Yeah, it's more like it.
Yeah. It crashes on this, basically, penal colony planet.
Yes.
It's like a penal colony / mining planet. Out in the total backwoods of the universe, so to speak.
Well, better place for a penal colony.
No. The ship crashes, and the only survivor is Ripley. Corporal Hicks is dead. The little girl...
Newt.
Oh my god, she turned me into a newt.
A newt?
I got better. Newt is dead and Bishop has been labeled destroyed beyond repair.
Yes.
So, here's right away where the differences started in the movie, but let me just finish off the recap here, and then we'll get into that. So, Ripley is the only survivor. Ripley, unbeknownst to herself and unbeknownst to everybody in the station, or in the penal colony, has an alien, spoilers, queen inside of her. A facehugger got on board her escape craft, killed the others, has an alien queen inside of her. It also then implants an alien into the local dog.
That would one be the version. Theatrical version.
In another version, it implants it into an ox.
Which, why do they have oxes?
Food and pull things, I guess.
Well, what about all those cranes?
Yeah, I don't know. All
right.
But,
again, we'll get into that.
Yeah. So, once again, we have an alien that is terrorizing everybody in this penal colony. It's a penal colony full of men that haven't seen a woman in years. And they're all rapists, killers, murderers, thieves.
Crazy people.
Pedophiles. Mostly rapists, you know, I noticed. But they've all taken a vow of celibacy because they all got religion now. And let's just say Ripley's presence disrupts things.
Greatly.
And then the alien disrupts things even more.
Geez, I wonder why.
The one thing I liked about this particular movie a lot is that it showed, and I don't know if this is really a pro, but it's just something to add. Because the alien that is used in the film was produced out of an animal instead of a human, it takes on some animalistic characteristics. Like, it runs on all fours. It takes on some of their characteristics instead of some of the other alien-like characteristics.
Yeah,
and it's a little bit different than the other ones we've seen, and it shows how diverse the aliens are. Now, I've heard a lot of people talk about how they didn't like some of the subsequent sequels because the aliens didn't look just like they did in the first and second one. Well, the more I thought about that, the more I realized, you know, not all of us humans look alike. Why should all the aliens look alike?
True.
And as I said, depending on what host they came out of, I think it adopts some of those. I mean, hence the Predalin, you know?
Predalin?
Yeah.
I've never heard it called the Predalin.
Yeah, it's the Predalin or Predalien or whatever they want to call it in Alien vs. Predator. Yeah, Predalin. It's a lot of people call it the Predalin for short.
Okay.
But, anyways. the Super Predator. Super alien, whatever. Doesn't matter.
No, it's neither here nor there right now.
Yeah, we'll get there.
Yeah.
But I just got me thinking, you know, what is the big deal about that? It just shows the diversity of the creatures and that they can do that. I mean, the queen is obviously not the same. They have some of the same characteristics. They all have basically the same head, but this one had a little bit different coloring. I think also because it came out of a dog instead of a human. You know, yeah. Or an ox, depending on which version you're watching.
Yeah.
So.
Depending. But all in all, this is a decent film, but this is probably the film that gets the most shit out of the entire franchise.
And I don't understand either. I've always enjoyed Part 3.
I don't understand it myself. I honestly don't understand why people give this movie so much shit. Yeah. I honestly don't.
I've always enjoyed it. I think it's a really good follow-up for the first two. People are probably going to crap on me for saying this, but I think it's a better follow-up for one than two is. Now, two, I love the film. Don't get me wrong. I love the movie. But you're talking about like the way the movie feels to me, it feels more like one than it does like two. Two felt more like an action movie.
Mm-hmm.
This one feels scary again. Or, I mean, not really scary to me, but it feels like it's a scary, like a horror movie again.
Okay.
But I've always liked it. I think 3 is a good film. I don't see why it gets... In fact, there's none of these movies I don't like.
Yeah.
No.
But that's something good for the comment section. If you've got beef with this film, tell us.
Let us know what you guys think down below, definitely.
In the comments, say, you know, this is why I think that this is a piece of shit. You know, because I just... don't get why it gets so much bad.
And I've never heard anybody tell me why either. I just hear that they don't like it or it's crap, but I never hear why. So.
Yeah. So, here's your chance. Give us some whys. All right. Where do you think we should start?
Let's start with the pros.
Okay. That sounds good.
My first pro is, honestly, the recreation of tension from the original. And they did it by doing what they did in the original and using one alien.
Yes.
Now, in two, do I love all the hordes of aliens and all the action? Yeah, it was great.
It was a different spin on it. Gave mm-hmm. you more of the hive aspect than right. the single.
But with this, they really brought it back to the original with that one alien. And, you know, it's stalking people. They didn't have a lot of weapons like, you know, they didn't in the original. They didn't have, guns and all the stuff they had in the sequel.
Actually, they had less in this one.
Yeah, they had even less. They had a couple knives and some, you know, fire axe or two and some, you know, broom handles. But I just really enjoyed it. I do. I really like the alien. He's going through the vents again, the air shafts, the, you know. And it just really brought back that feel of the original for me. And that is something I really enjoyed about this movie.
Okay, yeah, I can see that. I can definitely see that. My first pro for this film would probably have to be just the set itself. Like you said, the different places for it to hide and to stalk mm-hmm. from. It was a great setting. This penal colony was really nice. You had areas, like you said, that were very close and claustrophobic. And then you have other areas that are large.
And wide open, but still dungeon-like, you know.
Yeah.
And it had that great-looking setting to it, and it looked really good.
Yes. Like, it used to be in use, but now it's not. Right. It's got that forgottenness to it.
It looked very... Yeah, it definitely looked more intimate, I guess, than the, you know, sterile environment of the ships and stuff.
Yeah. Even the med lab didn't look that used and kind of archaic.
Yeah, it all looked all old and, you know, kind of crappy.
Yeah.
Crappy in a good way, obviously. I mean, that's what we enjoyed about it.
Oh, yeah.
Excuse me. A little indigestion. My next pro is the gore in this movie. They do really good on alien kills. Yeah. They do really good on, like, when the fan chops the dude up. I mean, looked really good. Lots of blood spatter, lots of
pieces.
You know, and, you know, I love blood spatter. That's a huge thing for me in these movies. I like to see a lot of blood going everywhere. I love seeing, like, the one dude when he, the guy who... he's like super crazy in the movie, and he's the only survivor of the three down in the basement of the thing. And he gets the blood just sprayed all over his face, and he looks like he just walked out of Friday the 13th. You know what I'm saying? I mean, he looks horrendous, and it just looks so good. It looks so cool.
The guy was already nuts before then.
Yeah.
But then, having that happen, then it flipped him over the edge.
I actually have a con involving him, but we'll get to
that. Yeah, we'll get to that. My next pro is the lighting of this film. To go along with the set, it's the lighting. The lighting's perfect. It's not too dark, but it's not very bright either.
And it's
very
cool
few
color.
Parts. Very few parts do you actually have brightness. Mm-hmm. Mostly, it's a darker film. The lighting's great.
And it's lit in kind of a orangish-brownish kind of way.
Which fits with the set.
It really makes it look, it gives it a better motif. It just looks really good.
Yes. So the lighting's definitely a pro in this film, which there are others that the lighting's a problem.
Yeah, in this franchise alone, there's some lighting's a big problem.
Yes, we'll get there.
So overall, I like this movie, but I only have one more pro that I want to actually talk about. Overall, everything, I like this movie. There's not a lot that I find bad with it. It's got some cons, but...
It does.
You know, it's a movie I enjoy. And it's kind of like Jason, my buddy, Horrific Nightmares. Jason says, it's a great popcorn film.
Oh, okay.
It's a movie just to chill out, you know, watch. It doesn't go into a lot of the scientific stuff like in the first one, things like that. And you just kind of chill out and watch things unfold, you know, eat a little popcorn. Hmm. You're good, you know. But the one last thing I want to talk about is I love the look of the alien.
Oh, yeah.
I think he looks cool. He's got that little reddish tinge to his head. I like that. I like that it's, you know, he does go on all fours. I like his design.
Yep.
I think he looks really, really cool. I mean, it's your basic alien design, but it has its own features, and I really enjoy that.
Again, to go with coming from an animal.
Exactly. I really like that. I think that's a really, I think it's a really cool design for the alien. And in the credits, it actually says Alien 3 alien design by H.R. Giger.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe he was still alive at this point, so he actually did the work on this alien as well. He designed, like, this alien differently than the others. And I enjoyed that. I think it's really cool.
Excellent. I think you're right on that. And I only have one more pro for this film as well. And that is, again, like he said, it's more, we're back to more of a horror motif here than a sci-fi action. And that is the classic, the killer or monster makes one final scare. After he's got the hot lead poured on him, Morris is standing up there all, you know, like, ha, ha, ha. And he says, I hate bugs. And poof, there it comes right out of that hot lead and just goes for one more scare. I like that. Again, we're going back to more of a horror motif, so that is a pro for me, the final scare.
All right. You're right, it was Morris.
Yeah.
Anyways, yeah, definitely. So that's all the pros we got, guys. Going to our cons here.
Yes.
Some of my cons have to do with the difference between the theatrical and the directors.
That's my biggest con of this entire film.
The theatrical or the director's cut? The special edition?
The beginning of this movie. That, let's just get into it because this is one that we're going to be talking about for a little bit. And I guess we will share this. Our first con is some of the stuff that of the 2003 director's cut, which thank God they got rid of it for the theatrical. Like the whole beginning, the thing coming from an ox, the thing was dead.
No.
You know, that made no sense right there. It doesn't make any sense to me why they even have ox to begin with. What the hell are they feeding them?
But they also, too, they left some of the signs of the dog in.
Yeah.
Even though you don't see the dog, they left signs of the dog in parts of the original theatrical cut where it concerns the dog, but it wasn't. There's no dog.
Yeah. Yeah, you don't see the dog. Like when Murphy is going in there in the director's cut, he's still saying, Spike, Spikey, what are you doing down there?
Yeah.
And that, of course, made no sense because we never really saw the dog. Who is he talking to? Who's Spikey? And then he gets, you know, sucked into the fan and everything. But just a lot of problems there with the opening. It was a little long. A lot of it didn't make any sense. In fact, most of it didn't make any sense.
It makes for an interesting, different kind of film, and I think it's just up to personal taste whether you like it or not.
Yeah, it was fun to watch, you know, for something we had never seen before. It was fun to watch, but I can definitely see why they cut this out.
Something I'm glad they cut out that they did leave into the director's special edition is, what was the name again? The crazy one?
Gullick.
I'm bad with these names, guys, sometimes. I really am. But Gullick thinks that the alien is God in the special edition. And there's even this whole storyline where he thinks like he has some sort of telepathic link to it. And like all this stuff. And I'm like,
yeah.
Boy, man, what is this? Is this Halloween 5 or something? What the hell?
The guy was already nuts to begin with.
Yeah, and I'm glad they cut all that out, though. They cut it all out, and they just made it where he was talking about the dragon again, and that in the theatrical version, and that's what I keep saying they cut it out, but the theatrical version is the version we got originally. So
yeah,
and the original version we got, it was just better. I didn't like that part. That is one of my cons.
Again, it just didn't really fit. It fit him being crazy, but it didn't fit the film very well.
Right.
And yeah, you're absolutely right there. Didn't care for it.
It just seemed like it was added and not needed. You know, it made the film longer for no reason.
And also, They actually do catch it in the waste, toxic waste thing. You know, they didn't do that in the original theatrical. They never caught it in there. Mm-hmm. And then Gullick lets it out.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Like you said, it's apples and oranges. It's Halloween 6 and Halloween 6 Producer's Cut. Two totally different things happen in the film. I mean, we got things that happen in the special edition that take the film in an entirely different direction than it did in the theatrical version.
Yep.
You know, I'm sure there's lots of people out there that prefer that. I don't know. I really haven't talked to many people about it.
Maybe there is. So. But anyway, it was nice to see, you know, because we hadn't seen it before. But not a fan. The theatrical version was way better.
Yep, I agree.
All right, what you got next?
Oh, I thought it was your turn, but that's okay. Also in the director's cut or special edition cut, they add a lot more scenes with like the just people interactions and stuff like that. And we get to see more of the overseer being a gigantic douche. Oh, now, he's kind of douchey in the theatrical cut. You right, bro?
Yeah.
But in the director's cut or special edition cut, whatever you want to call it, he is a major douche.
He's an ass.
And I get that, all right, I don't know, that's not really a con against the movie. It's just like they put so much more time and effort into the interactions with him that weren't really needed.
No, because he was going to be dead. Not even halfway through the film, maybe halfway. I don't know.
Like the office scene where he's meeting with what's the doctor's name?
Well, I forget his name.
Yeah, I forgot too. And I just watched this movie again this morning. But when he's meeting with the doctor in his office, in the theatrical version, it starts with him already drinking his drink and look, if you ever fuck with me again, you know, and that's where it starts.
Cut you off.
That's where it starts in the theatrical version. In the director's cut, he comes in, he gets him some tea, they talk for a little bit, blah, 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 and then he jumps into all that. And it just seemed like a bunch of needless things thrown in.
Yeah.
So we are talking about two different versions of the movie here. We're basically giving you two reviews in one.
Yeah, it is kind of two reviews.
And, but yeah, that was a con for me. I didn't like the fact that we got to see more of douchey characters that I didn't care about.
Yeah, why? Why? It was just added nonsense that didn't need to be there. I agree with that. My next con is, why exactly did they kill off Corporal Hicks and Nuke and pretty much just get rid of Bishop for this movie? Why?
I guess I
could see... Could they not get the people who played them to come back? They got Black.
His body was there, wasn't it? Didn't they show him, or did they not actually show his body?
No, they didn't even show him.
They showed the little girl, but only from, like, the eyes up. So
So I kind of wondered, why did we just throw these characters away? Why did we just throw them out? You know, and
maybe they were trying to recreate the ending of part one, where she's the only survivor.
It just didn't seem right from the transition from Aliens to Alien 3 that we have something invested in these characters. Oh, guess what? They're dead. You're not even going to get to see them on screen, and you'll get very little of Bishop. I just wonder why. Why did we just throw away these characters that we already had some invested time in?
Right.
And just poof. Why?
And maybe you can answer this because you're more into this series than I am to this franchise.
Yeah.
You know more about it than I do, but okay, maybe it's just because they killed it or I didn't see it. But after a facehugger gets somebody, doesn't the facehugger die?
Yeah, it just dies and lays wherever the heck it.
Okay, that's what I thought.
Yeah.
I thought that was the case in the original, and then they killed a bunch of facehuggers in the sequel, in the second one. But in this one, the facehugger that implants Ripley, it was the only one, as far as we know, on the ship, and it's still alive.
Well, no, there were two.
To get the dog. Was there two? They didn't show. I didn't see if there was two or if it was two different ones.
There's two different ones.
Because she didn't have it on her face again after.
No,
and they didn't find any sign of it.
They didn't find that one, and then there was another one alive. So, yeah, there two of them.
How did they get on there, though, at the end of the second movie?
Well, the queen was already on there.
The queen was, but I didn't see it drop any eggs or leave any facehuggers anywhere.
I don't know.
That's one of the things I have. Like you said, they got rid of some characters, and they added that just to make the sequel that it didn't make sense on why or how.
Yeah, so. You're right, and it doesn't. Again, the transition from from two to three is
a little bit...
We're leaving a few bits out here to make it make more sense.
Yeah, a few plot holes there.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, yeah. That too. You're right. Mm-hmm. That too. It's like, why? Where? How? That one's more of a how.
Right.
Mine is a why.
Right.
Okay.
So but it all involves that opening. And yes. That, you know, so that's why I brought it up there.
Yeah.
So. The last thing I've got for a con is the CGI in this movie. They went with the close-up scenes or where the alien's right in your face. It looked like it was, you know, a puppet or, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
But when the alien is moving, they use a lot of CGI, and it didn't look good. I mean, yes, this was early days CGI still, you know.
It didn't look good, though.
It just didn't look good, and I didn't enjoy it. And then at the end of the movie, the fire... At the end of the movie, doesn't look good. The one that Ripley falls into, I didn't think it looked good. It looked kind of like her body just kind of fell through the screen almost.
Yeah.
Like the flames didn't have any effect, or they were just kind of like, ooh, Bill. There was no reason, you know, and it didn't look like
the CGI was not good in this film. It was. I prefer practical effects myself.
Like I said, I'm a lover of CGI effects when it's done right. I like CGI when it's done right. I think CGI is a great tool because...
It is.
As George Lucas said once, you only have so many places and things you can film on this planet. There's only so many things.
Yeah.
So, you know, putting some CGI in some things and making, like, cool environments or different whatever, you know, that's cool. I like that. There's a lot of great CGI films out there that I really love the look of them, like Great and Powerful Oz, some of the Star Wars movies, you know, all... A lot of the, even in the prequels, a lot of people give shit to the prequels, but especially in like Revenge of the Sith, I really like some of the environments they made out of CGI.
Yes.
Lava planet, the planet with those giant mushroom things.
I prefer CGI to stay with the background. You know, I prefer that.
When it comes to gore and all that?
I want practical effects. I don't want CGI. I want makeup and effects. You know. Like you said, the background and stuff. That's background. That's
if you're trying to put in like a whole army of things, and you need,
yeah,
you
that's
know,
great. But
you know, like the Yoda battle, that was cool. But
yeah,
you know,
but
like
still, I like
in this
close-ups.
Particular situation, I would have preferred practical as well.
Yes, when it comes to that, practical effects and makeup are hands down the king if you do it right. Again, you have to do that right too.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of these companies nowadays, even especially nowadays, they don't want practical effects. They don't want any. They want everything to be CGI. It's like, no. Especially my blood and gore. My blood and gore's got to be makeup and practical effects. Sorry. Yep. Keep the CGI away from it.
Yeah,
you're ruining a lot of it.
I mean, there's a few horror movies where they did the CGI right, like in Friday the 13th remake, but... Usually when they try to use CGI in the horror movies, it just doesn't look very good.
No, it looks pretty generic and crappy.
It looks matted is what it looks like to me. Like, they kind of pasted it on top. You know, and that's how I feel it is with this alien. It looks like they took the background scenery and just pasted him on top while he's running through.
Yeah, it's not good. Alright, I still got one more con to this film.
Okay.
And, I'll just lump this in here that why does it take so long for the alien inside of Ripley to gestate and come out? Why does that take so long?
I found that funny too, because whether it's the dog or the ox,
it doesn't take long.
It went like that. It got infected. A couple hours later, bam, there it is. There's your alien.
Yeah.
But maybe it's because it was a queen. I don't know.
I don't know.
But it
it's
took
never,
the whole movie. You
know? It's never taken that long in any of these films. This is the only film that it takes this long. So as far as big beefs go, maybe I can see that being one of them.
And the only reason for that is because they need their star.
Well, they need the star of the show.
You know, at least the last till the end. Well, I'll give them that. At least they didn't kill her off the first 10 minutes like they do with freaking Lori in Halloween Resurrection. You know? But maybe that honestly would have made more sense in this particular movie.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, it might have, but then it made sense why the alien wouldn't hurt her.
Yeah.
That made perfect sense.
That's the only thing I could think of a reason why it took so long is because it was a queen instead of something else.
Yeah, maybe.
But they don't ever actually explain it.
They don't. They don't explain it at all. Yeah, that just happened. Like, why does it take so long? It's never taken this long before.
Yeah.
Hmm. Okay, well, that's all I have.
And then at the end of the third act, she's like, I don't have much time left. Like, she knew it was coming out soon. You know?
Yeah. I don't know. Anyways, that's it for our pros and cons for this film.
Overall, we both really like this movie. I know it catches a lot of crap from people, and I definitely would like to know why. So if you're not a fan of this movie, please tell me.
Please tell us why.
Nobody ever tells me why. They just say they don't like it, or it's the shitty film, or it's the worst one in the franchise. At least till Alien vs. Predator came out.
At least give a why. I want the why.
Yep.
I don't mind if you don't like this film. That's your opinion. We don't mind it.
Nope.
It's not the best film in the franchise, but come on, people, give us some whys. Put it in the comment section. Give us some whys.
Why?
Yeah. I know. Why ask why when how is so much more fun?
I don't know. Anyways, guys, that is it for us today. You got anything else you want to add?
No.
Me either. So, this is Bronco Juggalo saying peace.
And Bill saying good night.
Let's meet contestant number one. He's a schizophrenic serial killer clown who says women love his sexy smile. Let's find out if his charm will work on Sharon. Sharon, what's your question?
Contestant number one, I believe first impressions last forever. So let's say you were to come over to my parents' house and have...